Hey, welcome to today's broadcast on the same page. I'm Dan Frank, on the same page with God. We've got an intense topic to talk about here today, and no, that's not where we wanted to be. I gotta get on the right page here first. No. Okay. Well, Daniel, what did you do with it? There. Hey, this is tough reading right here. In fact, I better shorten this up. But I promise that today, all we have to do is this one little bit here, and I'll set it up here, and this is from, we're going to talk about King Kong today, of all things. I mean, and this broadcast is going to get all over the place. You know, what I think was going on with King Kong as he was climbing up the Empire State Building. Amen. Of course, I'm being facetious, but we are going to touch on that in just a second to make a point. If I don't lose my way. Amen. Praise God. Anyway, and we're going to talk about two prominent figures in rocketry, and you think, well, what could that have to do with God? Well, it has to do with this question, and we'll come back to this later on after we talk about the examples I'm going to give and how they factor into it. But this is from the book of Jubilees. This is the 10th chapter. And the verses that matter are the 8th and 9th that speak specifically to what we're talking about. And even though this is in the Jubilees, which is not in the Bible, this is also talked about in 1 Peter 3, verses 18 through 20, where Jesus goes and preaches to imprisoned spirits. And I believe these here in Jubilees chapter 10, verses 8 and 9 are the imprisoned spirits he's talking about. I believe there's high probability. I don't think there's anything for absolute certainty because, you know, we can all make mistakes and have errors in judgment. But I believe that this passage here in 10th Jubilees and 1 Peter chapter 3, verse 18 through 20, where Jesus goes and preaches or teaches to imprisoned spirits. This is after he rose from the grave. I believe that they're one and the same events. And there's a real good question. You see these courtroom dramas where they get the guy on the stand and, you know, and they start, the attorney starts wrangling around and, you know, it comes up, is there a question? Because I think there should always be a question, you know. And I don't have all the answers. And I don't know that I have this answer. I have one portion of it, but it's a question to you. I want you to pursue this. Because to me, this is one of the greatest questions out there. After years of reading my Bible, even though Jubilees is not in the Bible, I still think, like I said, because it's mentioned, this very event is mentioned in 1 Peter, I think it's worth our consideration. But let me set the backdrop for you in the which it speaks of here in the first seven verses of 10 Jubilee. It'd be easier for me to just paraphrase it to you rather than to read it. This is the sons of Noah come to Noah, and they were complaining about angels, basically, that had led people astray. And we know the angels came down at that point and took upon themselves human wives. Well, the sons of Noah were complaining about this to Noah. So Noah goes and he prays to God about it. Amen. What a smart move right there. And then he says, I have to kind of look around my camera to read this because they're actually in front of my screen. And in the sixth verse here, he says, this is Noah, and he says, let not them rule over the spirits of the living, of men. Thou alone canst exercise dominion over them, over us. And let them not have power. He's talking about these spirits. Not that let them have power over the sons of righteousness and henceforth forevermore. And the Lord God bade us to bind all. In other words, to bind up these spirits. And then, boy, I didn't do this very well. I should have set this up different. But we got what we got. Only got two more verses to read. But then this angel comes forth, and he's the chief of the imprisoned spirits. Now, I cannot pronounce his name, but anyway. And the chief of the spirits, Mastema, this is in verse 8 of 10 Jubilees, came and said, Lord, Creator, let some of these imprisoned spirits reign before me, and let them hearken to my voice and do all that I say to them. For if some of them are not left to me, I shall not be able to execute the power of my will on the sons of men. For these are for corruption and leading astray before my judgments. For great is the wickedness of the sons of men. And then God's response to him, God goes along with this. Amen. This is the part that baffles me. And God said, let the tenth part of them remain before him, and let nine parts descend onto the place of condemnation. So, you know, this chief, Methesema, I can't, who knows what it is. Read it. Amen. Praise God. And he goes and makes this, he said, hey, leave me some of these wicked spirits. Don't condemn them all. In other words, I can't carry out my mission. Amen. And God goes along with it. God says, you can have a tenth part of the wicked angels, but send nine tenths of them into condemnation. Amen. Okay, we're done with that. And that to me is a question that is very thought-provoking. I don't have a full answer. I think I have part of an answer. But it's an interesting question. What is God doing? Does it show us that God can be facetious sometimes, that he can just go along with something because he knows how it's going to turn out? And it just sounds like he's going along with the guy, but is there more to the story? And I want to bring something up. This is from 1 Corinthians chapter 10, and it says twice here, let's see, in verse 6, now these things took place as examples for us, that we might not desire evil as they did. And I think it's here, it's repeated in verse 11. Now these things happened to them as an example, but they are written down for our instruction, to whom the end of the ages have come. And you know, and I've said this many times, Paul thought he was preaching to the last generation right there. So many preachers do today. And I don't think that at all. I mean, I this is September 15th, I think, of 2023. And it would be I would be shocked if Jesus returned this century. And it may be five centuries or many centuries before he comes back. And the big reason that I say that has to do with the full inclusion of Israel that is suggested by Romans chapter 11. I think it's verse 11 and 12. And we're nowhere near that full inclusion of Israel. We can't even see it on the horizon, yet Jesus says it's going to happen. So how can he come back until we've at least moved towards it, you know? And I don't see it, you know? And here, he's just given us example twice in 1 Corinthians 10, verse 6 and verse 11. He said, now these things happen unto them as an example, but they are written down for our instruction, on whom the end of the age has come. And so what I want to make with that is that often when things are written in the Bible, it's been written down to instruct us in later times, you know, not just that final generation in the end times, but people throughout history, you know, so that we can move closer. The instruction means to do what? So that we can move closer to him, closer to God. Amen. Praise God. Just wanted to make that point in passing here. Okay, I promised you I would show you where 1 Peter. This is 1 Peter chapter 3. Best place to start is in 18. And this is when right after Christ rose from the grave. And this is the first thing he does when he rose to the grave. And that really suggests something to me that this is important, more so than we pay attention to it. I have a feeling of why I think we don't pay attention to it. But for Christ also suffered once for our sins, the righteous for the unrighteous, that he might bring us to God, being put to death in the flesh, but made alive in the spirit, in which he went and proclaimed to spirits in prison. Because they formerly did not, well, let's back up a minute. The five major denominations of Christianity here in the United States, and no two of them agree on who he's talking about being imprisoned spirits. Now, what we read in Jubal's suggests that these are the imprisoned spirits of angels, and that gives us about a 90% probability that that's who he's talking about. But it, no way is it a slam dunk. You know, it's still just like 90% probability, even with the text from Jubal's. But this too has often puzzled me. What puzzles me is, why is Jesus proclaiming to imprisoned spirits unless there's some hope for him? There has to be a point in him proclaiming to imprisoned spirits. Sorry about the dog. He's chasing something. Has to be a point to it. Jesus wouldn't do that for no reason. There is some point to that. And so why does he tell us here in 1 Peter 3, verse 19, in which in his spirit he went and proclaimed to spirits in prison? And then he goes on and leans it a little bit to more that they are angels, because they formerly did not obey when God's patience waited in the days of Noah while the ark was being prepared, in which as few as that eight persons were brought safely through the water. There's five major denominations, and they all have different interpretations of one. One says that that Jesus was preaching to imprisoned men, a very huge denomination. In fact, we'll say one of the biggest, one of the certainly most notable denominations in the United States says that he was preaching to imprisoned men. Now, I don't think any others agree with that, but some say that these were imprisoned angels, or would be demons, and literally. And the problem I have with that, and when we fix it to the time of Noah, if we're going to say that they were in prison because they didn't wait with patience in the time of Noah while the ark was being prepared, then that says that the ark possibly says something about angels. And, you know, why are they commanded to wait unless maybe the ark had something to do with them too? And we don't know a thing about that. You know, that's just speculation. There's another. So one group believes that these were the imprisoned spirits of men. One believes that they were imprisoned spirits of angels. Another believes that Jesus went back physically to the time of Noah. In other words, time traveled back and preached to them in that era. Some say that he was part of Noah's spirit and was preaching to the imprisoned angels back then. That, you know, and what that bothers me, because we have five major denominations and I don't know that any of them know the truth, except it maybe if we can say there's probably a 90% probability that these were the imprisoned spirits of angels, only because of the reference over in Jubals. But the evangelicals, I'm one, who generally throw out the book of Jubals, would object to that. And that's the only thing that really gives us the strength, other than the complaint in verse 20, because they formally did not obey. God's patience waited for them in the days of Noah while the ark was being prepared. Big issues, you know. Why? What was going on? Let's see if I can get to the right. No. Okay. I want to go back and look at a couple of men in our rocket program, and maybe they can give us just a clue as to what's going on. And I think it's in part what we first talked about over here in here. That now these happened as an example to us. They're written down for our instruction. So, you know, when something is written down there over in where we just came from, in 1 Peter 3, you know, where he's talking about, for Christ also suffered for our sins. Get down here to verse, in which in his spirit he went and proclaimed the spirits in prison. It could be this is too just an example for us that he would do that type of thing. You know, it might not just be that these are words to convey information, but this is written down specifically as an example for us, and which we need to pay attention to it and get all that we can in hopes that it takes us closer to him. And I believe if we get it correctly, it will take us closer to him. Amen. Praise God. These are in reverse order, but I want to talk about this guy. He's tied up with rocketry, but in an odd way. His prodigy, who is Konstantin Teslovsky, I'm sure I said that wrong, is actually the one that did the rockets in Russia. But this guy, Nikolai Fedorov, Teslovsky was his prodigy. In other words, he was a librarian back in the day. He took him under his wing and educated him when Teslovsky was having some difficulties. And in fact, I'll show you later as we're leaving. I've already made a video about this aspect of him and Teslovsky and go into a little bit more detail. But he wrote this book called The Common Task. I'm not seeing it here. Yeah, right here. And The Common Task of, I think that's the title of the book, by Fedorov, in which he had an idea that it was incumbent upon the living men to raise the dead and transport them, in other words, exhume them from the graves and transport them to other worlds. And this is why he was insanely interested in Teslowski when Teslowski came along and had these ideas about rockets. It played right in to Fedorov, which he believed that man was destined to do this, to either, he's a precursor to transhumanism. You can read about him. But he believed that we were either to resurrect men and women from the grave bodily, or their spirits, to remove their spirits and transport them to distant worlds. And this is in part why Russia was hammering to get in space, why there was actually a space race, is because this guy back in the day so convinced the Russian hierarchy that this is something that men were destined to do. And the point I want to make is, I don't know that he read this anywhere. He just picked it up in his spirit and he ran with it. And he said, no, this is the way it's got to be. This is what we've all got to be about. This was Fedorov. And there's things to admire about him. He was very frugal. He would not promote himself at all, which is why you don't know much about him. There is a very good documentary by, I think, Werner Heisog about him. It's very good. But let's move on to... And the reason we're talking about him is our space race between NASA and Russia that we've spent just... in the United States, about $2 trillion over the last 40 or so years was all because of these two guys. This is Teslowski. I can't say it. This is Teslowski, you know. What's his first name? Nothing. I don't know. You just imprison. Oh, so I'm still talking about imprisoned spirits. This is a blog I made about, when did I publish this? It says 4 years ago, in 19, I published this. This is Teslowski, Konstantin Teslowski, and he was Fedorov's prodigy. In other words, Fedorov took him under his wing. But Teslowski is also known as the father of Russian rocketry. And there's an amazing story about him. I don't want to get into it because it's a lot of details, probably right in this video. If you go Google under YouTube, just look up YouTube and put in your search line, Jesus taught imprisoned spirits in heaven. And it's going to take you to this guy, Teslowski. But he is the father of Russian rocketry. He's the one that put shoes on the race that Fedorov envisioned. And the reason I think this is important, one of the reasons, is we spent $2 trillion chasing what was erroneous. You know, we're not, as people, tasked to pull people out of the grave and transport them to distant planets, as Fedorov suggested we are. That's not our common task, as he said. It's not. You know, God automatically does that when people die. Their spirit, you know, goes into a place of storage, in my way of looking at it. You know, I know the popular Hollywood version is that you're immediately judged by God, and I don't think so, because there's, if you look up in the Bible, under the Witch of Endor, and that's a famous boat, but it was also a witch in the Old Testament. And one of the prophets went and had her summon one of the other prophets to ask about a battle he was going into. And this guy that he summoned, she got him and opened up a communication for him. And he says he was ticked off. He said, why have you awakened me? I was in sleep. So however many years he'd been dead, he was resting and enjoying his sleep. Amen. Praise God. So, you know, that's just an example of him. But what does 1 Corinthians tell us? That these things are written down for examples for us. So I think we can kind of take from that, when we die, nothing necessarily happens. You know, I don't know. I've not died. And I've not had any of those near-death experiences. You know, I've not went towards a light or anything like that. And I don't know, could happen tomorrow. I'm 69. But let's hope not. I'm here as long as God's here to have me. Amen. Praise God. But this guy's worth looking into. But he and Fedorov are the whole, and Fedorov's idea that we are to raise the dead and transport them to distant galaxies, that's the reason we had a space race. And my argument is that if we can spend $2 trillion, American dollars, over the last 4 or 5 decades to chase an erroneous idea, what would happen if we could get on the right track? And we could start pursuing Christ the way he wants us to, and elevating him and not some task that man assumes is appropriate. Amen. Just, we could just glorify him. You guys sit down. Hey, both of you, go lay down. Lay down. Now go on. Dogs. I love them. Hey, they're pain sometimes. Good, you're pain. Let's go on to, there's a third guy, because I think it's the elemental difference is wrapped up in this third guy. Do I have him? No, he's not there. He's not there. Not there. Not there. We talked about him the other day. Oh, come on, Daddy. What'd you do with him? This guy. This is Werner von Braun. And he's not the father of American lottery rocketry. He was a German who worked with Adolf Hitler, worked for Adolf Hitler. And when that's really right at the crux. Let me come back to that. In this picture, this was on the launch of Apollo 11 in 69. And I remember that day. I was just a teenager. I think there's some pictures of his family here. This is von Braun here in the middle. He was a very charismatic guy. But the Saturn V rockets, that's his wife. Here's his gravestone, and by the way, he was a Christian. He accepted Jesus. And I think here's his whole family. I think this is von Braun. This is Alabama senator, because when he came here, he went to Huntsville, I believe, for NASA. And this is Alabama's governor, and this is his wife and daughters and family. Werner von Braun. That Saturn V rocket that carried us to the moon was all von Braun. I mean, he was the genius that put us, that gave us the leg up in the space race. And then, but the neat thing about von Braun, see, he was a German scientist when World War II was going on. That V rocket, you know, I forget what they called them, you know, that they were using these rockets to bomb England. That was his creation. You know, he was doing all that. And as the war wound down, you know, he knew he had to choose whether to go to Russia or come to the United States. And he was not a Christian at that point. And I cannot find it, but I remember reading somewhere a few years ago that what led him to lean towards the United States and come to the United States and work in our rocketry program was he said, I didn't want to go to a country where that having faith in God would be paddling against the current, against the tide. In other words, he felt, as I'm not saying that Russia doesn't have a religious system. They do. And in some cases, it works. But in a lot of cases, it doesn't. And when the government has wanted to shut the churches down, they shut them down, you know, and almost to the point that they would call them atheists. But then when they want to bring them back, they brought them back in the time of Putin. Why? I don't know. But von Braun saw that the atmosphere to faith in Russia as being swimming upstream against the current. And he says, I wanted to be somewhere where I could flow downstream and just ease into Christian faith. Because he said, I didn't want to have to fight to get into it. I didn't want to have to fight the government. And he said, that seemed much more plausible to me in the United States. I remember I read this, I don't recall where, but we wouldn't have near, we might have lost the space race without von Braun. I mean, he, John Glenn, all of that was made possible by von Braun. There's just no getting around it. Amen. He was our German scientist that let us supposedly win the space race. But I remember when I was reading about von Braun, when he first got here, he asked about Goddard. And I can't remember Goddard's first name. But anyway, he said, where's Goddard? Because Goddard was the father of American rocketry. And what happened was, I mean, von Braun comes here in 45, 47, something like that. Goddard in 1927, was lecturing as a professor at Princeton, and he delivered a lecture about little green men that we'd someday go to Mars. And a reporter, you'll like this, maybe you'll like it. I don't know. Let me take a second here. There was a reporter, these are pictures of, you know, King Kong climbing the Empire State Building. And this is by Finis Dakes. He's a real good study. There was a reporter in 1927 that went to Princeton where Goddard was lecturing. And he listened to him talk about us going to Mars someday on rockets, and he came back and he wrote a scathing piece in the New York Times about, Goddard, and he characterized it as, he said, methinks that the button-down professor has come a little bit unbuttoned because the professor said, we're saying someday we're going to go to Mars. And he just couldn't imagine this New York writer from the New York Times just couldn't imagine that. And so Goddard drops his professorship at Princeton and goes to Roswell, New Mexico, and commences a 20-year sulk in which the U.S. rocketry program went absolutely nowhere. Nowhere. I mean, when von Braun got here 20 years later, we had the Redstone rocket, but I think we had the Atlas, but neither one of them were reliable vehicles. More of them were blowing up on the pad than were ever going, you know, even 1,000 feet off the pad. You know, 1,000 feet above the pad was a good day for Redstone and Atlas. You know, and von Braun changed all that. But von Braun knew that it was Goddard. So first thing von Braun did when he got here, he asked where Goddard was, and they said, "Oh, he's out in New Mexico." So von Braun went and got him. He said, "No, you come back here and you be a part of this, because none of us would be anywhere without your primary work." And the point I want to make here, I think this is where maybe this King Kong story comes from, is that the New York Times had their head so far up their, what's the word? I know the word, I'm just not going to say it. And so some writer, he comes up with this story to make it emblematic of that moment in 1927 when a writer from the New York Times single-handedly shut down our American rocketry program for 20 years. And my point is that we could have the same thing. The difference between von Braun and Fedorov is that Fedorov, he grabbed onto this idea about it has to be this way. We have to raise the dead and transport them into space. I'm going to wind up watching this movie tonight. I'm going to have to. Amen. Praise God. And whereas von Braun says, his whole decision on where he would go as a country after Germany was, he said, "I don't want to go somewhere where to believe in Christ and worship God is not paddling upstream. I want to go somewhere where the current flows with that." So he chose the United States, and he remained open about it rather than closed. And I think when we go all the way back here, I'm afraid I'll click on things that I don't. It's not Fedorov. It's not this. It's not that. Not that. Not that. I don't know. I should have made a bigger, better plan. I apologize. My failure. But, you know, we're locked in that Christianity, we've become increasingly locked in that Christianity is just this one way. Well, actually, we've splintered into 5 ways, you know, maybe 8, depending on how you count here in the United States. And that's a problem, you know. But we're not open to a bunch of increased understanding about God. We're more like Fedorov. We're locked into it has to be just this way, and everything else we reject. Well, von Braun, that's the key difference between them, and he was clearly the more astute and the more talented guy, and we were blessed beyond measure to get him. I want to make 2 points here. Number one, I think we need to open up to more thoughts that about Christ that don't conform to conventional Christianity. Not that they're necessarily right, but we need to be open and I don't like the word tolerant. I'll use it. But I think there are truths in God that we've yet to pull out. And if we go back to that where we started from 10th Jubals, you know, where why did God allow this head of the demons to say, "Hey, let a tenth of the wicked angels go back to earth and torment men, but send 90 of them to this place of damnation and judgment and imprison them there. What? Why did God allow, you know, if that was God's idea, okay, but it wasn't. It was the demon's idea. And I think in that verse in there, God has given us an example. You know, as he said in 10th Corinthians, you know, he's laid down that story as an example for us. And I think we need to be pursuing him. It's not those issues. It's him. We need to be glorifying his presence and praising him and wringing out from these scriptures everything we can. And if we remain open, I think ultimately this $2 trillion that we've spent in the space race from in the 50s and 60s until 2023, that will become chicken feed to what is available when we really pursue God, you know, wholeheartedly, openly, honestly, and we don't put up these barriers and say, well, you're not doing it our way, so you can't be. Even though I'm probably we're all like that. We want to say, hey, it's my way. But I think there's truths of God that are yet to unravel, and a bunch of them could come out as of why did God allow this head of the demons to make his case, and God went along with it, to lock up 90% of the imprisoned angels and send 10% to torment men. Why did God? I can see why God did it, but why did he allow the head of the demons to present that? Because, I mean, God certainly knew about that option, and yet he acted like he's acting on the demon's idea. What was going on there? You know, what was going on there? And I think if we can get in close enough to God to, you know, snuggle up to that, and what was he doing, and we can find maybe other places in the Bible where he was doing the same thing, we can get much closer and much tighter with God, and we can see a much greater exuberance of his will manifested here on earth, and not to bring people out of the graves, as Fedorov and Constantine would suggest, but, you know, just to pursue and glorify him. That $2 trillion we spent on the space race was chicken feed to what is available if we get tuned in and keep our focus on Jesus. Amen. This is Dan Frank for Stop on the Same Page with God. Amen. Praise God. You have a blessed day. And I've now finally figured out how to turn this thing off. Stop.